Now, Breitbart.com editor-in-large, it's Ben Shapiro, Fox News contributor, Father Jonathan Morris, Fox and Friends First co-host Ainsley Earhart. Ainsley, let's start with you and your report. Not Christian, not Jewish, it's universal.
It's universal.
The story of Noah comes from the Judeo-Christian.
Right, and that was his response when I asked him. He's one of the co-writers. I asked him why God versus why creator versus God. God is not used at all in the entire
film.
Saying? And he said that was his response. I wanted to make this universal, and the creator could be universal. It can be Muslim. It can be Jewish. It can be Christian. But I read the story of Noah today, and I counted the number of times God is used in the three books.
Good for you. All right, Ainsley, great research. How many?
All right, God is used 20 times, and Lord is used 9 times. So 29 times it's used. And so the question was that many of Christians are asking this day, or after they've heard about God not being used, is how can you write the book of Noah without God?
Without using those words that were actually used in the Bible. All right. I will be honest. I have been looking forward. I want to really see this movie. The Passion of the Christ is one of the best movies. I love Russell Crowe. I can quote Gladiator. Are you not entertained? I can do it all right now. You saw the movie last night. We're very, really good friends.
Yep.
And we think a lot alike.
Yeah.
And you just told me something I didn't want to hear.
You're not going to like it.
Why?
And the reason that you're not going to like it is because it is a complete reversal of what the biblical narrative is in terms of sin. I mean, the whole story of Noah is about man being sinful. And the word that's used in Hebrew is v'tishachet ha'aretz, right? That's from Genesis 6:11. It means the earth was corrupted. That typically is used to mean violence, sexual immorality. It's used to mean idolatry. In this movie, the great sin that humanity commits is degrading the environment. So the worst sins you can commit are apparently eating a hamburger, really, like not being a vegetarian.
Well, no, seriously. What,
dead serious.
We are destroying the planet to build the ark to save humanity? Is that the argument?
No. It's that all these city dwellers came and they created cities and they had to ruin the environment in order to create these massive cities. Overpopulation is the problem. So is the eating of animals. That's a big problem. The degradation of the environment by mining is a huge problem. So prehistoric fracking. And the idea behind all of this is to turn God into Gaia. So God is basically taking revenge. And the real kicker on this, and the part that's really disturbing, and spoiler alert here, but the part that's the kicker is that the great moral conflict for Noah becomes whether to kill his own family inside the ark after the rest of humanity has perished, because humanity is the enemy of the environment. And so the climactic scene is him standing over two newborn babies, deciding whether to kill them. I mean, he's standing there with a knife, deciding whether to kill them.
It should not be Noah. Noah's right.
I went to the Bible. That's closer to the story of Abraham. I did go to a seminary and studied theology for 4 years, as you know, Father Morris. Look, we're friends, and I have no doubt that I will probably see it the same way as Ben,
Here's the issue. The story of Noah is a relatively small story, 3 chapters in the book of Genesis, right? It's not, and so you need creative license. We think of the Passion of the Christ, you brought it up, where I worked for over 2 years on the set, and there's creative license. Did it happen exactly as the Passion? No. And that's okay. It's a film. It's just a film. But when you turn the story on its head, when you reverse the understanding of sin, when you change the nature of God, when you have the great moral dilemma being killing grandchildren, where the Bible didn't even mention that they existed. All he said was, bring your 3 sons and their wives onto the ark. And now we have, and unfortunately, the problem here is not that Aronofsky is a bad guy. I have no idea if he is or not. But when you write a story about a religious sacred text, and you don't start from the point of view of faith, you're going to have something that doesn't look anything like the sacred text.
This is disappointing.
Stephen Baldwin.
I hope we're wrong.
Stephen Baldwin's a good friend of yours. I saw him last night on the red carpet. He was in that piece. And he said, by the way, to tell you hello, but he is a very strong Christian. And he said that this is at least opening up the conversation, at least that kids can go and see the movie, get in the car with
Ben
their parents
rolling
afterwards.
His eyes.
It's ridiculous. I mean,
he hadn't seen it at this point.
Right,
he was walking the red carpet.
You hear all the actors there on the red carpet saying, nobody's seen it, so how can they? I've seen it. Okay, so I've seen the movie. I can criticize it now. What it does is it's the equivalent of making a movie about Martin Luther King, in which Martin Luther King is an advocate for racial inequality. It is literally taking sin and turning it on its head. What is now sinful is everything that it says the villain in the story is a guy who actually ends up quoting the beginning of Genesis, the earth is that you are masters of the earth, that you're given dominion over the birds and the flocks, all of this. The villain says that because you're not supposed to have mastery over all of these things. I mean, it's a deliberately misogynistic
point. The hopeful part of all of this is that we're talking about the Bible, no doubt. And what it means is that these stories, the real story, still has great weight. 2,000 years later,
you know,
we're talking about
how
something.
How do you have an atheist who says it's not about the Judeo-Christian ethic, it's to be universal, and then the way Ben describes this, that seems to me,
John,
to almost be, would I be wrong in saying maybe a mockery or just turning it into a...
It's a pagan myth, and no. You know, I'm probably more cynical than Father Morris a little bit, but
I hope it's ignorance.
It's willful ignorance,
which it might be. That's the
forgiving side of you.
Well, it's to make money. It's to make money. I mean, it's to take biblical stories and to make money off of
them. She went to the Bible. How many times did they mention God?
20
in the
times
story?
God and nine times Lord. And Ari, one of the writer that you saw there with the beard, he said, "Bible is full of tremendous stories, great narrative, and epic tales."
Absolutely, but tell the story.
Okay. Guys, really good job. Ainsley.
Thank you.
I love Russell Crowe. Gladiator. Are you not All right, I'm done. Thanks, guys. Good to see you. I probably will go see it just to see, and I'll write you first, Ben. All right, coming up next, serious controversy. Now, critics of the film, which chronicles a story from the Bible, say that it's not religious. They are arguing that it outlines an entirely different, and they say inaccurate, series of events. Meanwhile, the director, who is also a self-proclaimed atheist, has called his film, quote, the least biblical film ever made. So then why did he make a movie about Noah? Now, in light of this controversy, we sent out our good friend, Fox and Friends, first co-host Ainsley Earhart, to the red carpet, the big event, the premiere in New York City last night, to see what the actors had to say. Take a look.
There was a little bit of controversy about the film. Some Christians were upset and offended.
Everybody said,
What's your reaction?
I think it's foolish. They hadn't even seen the film.
Stay true to the Bible?
There isn't much about Noah in the Bible.
It was always going to provoke a certain amount of controversy. All biblical adaptions do. What Darren hasn't done so much as take liberties with the text, I would say, is fill in the gaps.
We're talking about the word God wasn't used, Creator was used.
Yes, we take a half step back from having it be a specifically Christian story or a Jewish story or a Muslim story, and it becomes a universal story.
But just some people are so conservative that they won't even accept it today. You know, there's no perfect way to do it, and in order to put it on screen, you got to pick and choose.
I talked to the writers. They said that they replaced God with the word creator.
Yeah, and there's, believe it or not, there are actually Bibles that exist now that have done the same thing.
You were talking about some of the critics of this show, and you said that it's stupid of them to be critical of this, and I know there's been some controversy. I just wanted to get your take on that.
Well, you know, it is kind of strange when people are willing to put their stamp and their name to a grand statement about something they haven't seen. The unfortunate thing is you've got a whole bunch of people who've already been infected by that stupidity, you know, and they seem to somehow think that this is a bad thing.
All right, joining me,
Ben, big fan. After I ask my question, can I get a handshake?
Yeah, sure.
All right, awesome. So just context, I've been actively promoting this event and inviting people to debate you in the Q&A. And many people thought that even if they were right, you would still win the debate due to your position of authority and argumentative wit. And so I'm here today to try.
I mean, they're right. I'll win, but yeah.
So I'm here to try my best to stump you and maybe show the naysayers it's possible. But I doubt it, like you said.
If you ask me, long division in my head.
So you state in an article titled, quote, "Why Atheism is Morally Bankrupt," that, quote, "without God, there is no capacity for free will." And you repeat the sentiment multiple times.
Yes.
You consistently claim to be able to pose secular arguments to support any of your claims, but it seems that your belief in free will is entirely rooted in religious argument. And you seem to indicate that if you had to take a secular view on the topic of free will, you would be forced to take a determinist position. Considering that the free will topic is at the core of the justice system, it seems to me that your arguments in favor of retributive justice are solely supported by religious arguments. Can you pose a secular argument in favor of free will?
Sure. I mean, I think that most atheists believe in free will and disagree with my central premise. So if I want to play atheist, I would say that there is a secular argument in favor of free will. As a religious person, I don't think it's a particularly compelling one. So in other words, the point that I'm making here is that you're right. Free will is at the center of the criminal justice system.
Yeah.
I believe that the argument in favor of free will has to rest on supernatural premises. Because otherwise, what you're basically saying is that human beings are a combination of their genetics and their environment. Mm-hmm. And if we just had a giant machine and we could pour all that information into a machine, then I could predict with perfect certainty what you were going to say next. Right, as it is, my machine's great. I can mostly predict what you're going to say next. But if I had all that information, then I could perfectly predict that, and then you wouldn't have any personal responsibility. And I haven't heard a great argument from atheists about why that's the case. Now, I say that it's a supernatural force. You can believe it's not a supernatural force. Mm-hmm. But I think that you can say from a secular point of view that you can believe free will exists without God existing. I don't think it's a compelling argument, but I think you can do that. And I've argued with secular people without mentioning God in the free will argument all the time. I mean, if you're an atheist, are you an atheist?
Yes.
Okay, so you're an atheist. Do you believe free will exists?
No.
You don't believe free will exists. So you tell me, how does the criminal justice system function?
Yes, yeah, so I would recommend a quarantine theory where you basically view someone as an actor. And so in an example, let's say someone is violent with someone else.
Mm-hmm.
You would say, okay, well, as a determinist, I'd say when you make a decision, you could not have chosen otherwise. So I'd view this actor and I'd say, well, you couldn't have chosen otherwise, so I don't hold you morally culpable, but it still tells me a lot about how you're liable to act in the future, and so we're going to treat you as a public health hazard and quarantine.
But that's not true. I mean, the problem with that argument is it's not true. If I kill my wife, right, mm-hmm. which I'm not going to, I like her.
Yeah.
If I kill my wife, the chances that I'm going to kill another human being are actually extraordinarily low. Right? People kill people they tend to know. The chances that I'm going to kill a bunch of other people are really, really low. The idea that I'm going to become a serial killer is not really true. Plus, I mean, you're actually creating a sort of Millennium Report problem, right? You actually have, what if you just say, you're now doing pre-crime. You're saying you're more likely to commit crime in the future, so we're going to put you in quarantine. The retributive theory of justice is basically this. You deserve to go to prison, and not only do you deserve to go to prison, if we didn't put you in prison, then what you'd end up with is people coming after you to commit revenge on you, and then you'd have a cycle of violence that would actually lead to terrible things. So if you want to argue against free will on the basis that... It's I'm thinking about it on the spot. It's a really interesting question. I suppose that I believe that in the end, Western civilization is based on a foundation of Judeo-Christian morality that is religious in nature, but I can't just say God. Like, when people ask me a question, I can't just say God if I want to have the argument. Maybe at the root, if you say free will, mm-hmm. when you get down to the root argument of a couple of these major things,
yeah.
then I will have to say God.
Okay.
But I think that the vast majority of political argument, it's important not to just cite to the Bible or to a deity.
All right. Thank you. Give a handshake.
Yeah.